Hello students, good morning. We are meeting after a long time, around after 2 months we are waiting. Today we are going to start the next unit from biology, that is heredity and variation. Already we have completed first unit of reproduction, 4 lessons in that we have completed. Then sir has completed the third unit, that is microbes in human welfare. In that you have learned 3 lessons, and today we are going to start the second unit, that is heredity and variation. Again, very important unit. If we see its board weightage is also higher. This unit has 18 marks weightage. For NEET point of view also, this unit is very important because number of questions come from this unit. This unit has 3 lessons. First one, that is principles of inheritance and variation. Second lesson, that is molecular basis of inheritance. And third one, that is evolution. From this, I'll be dealing with 2 lessons. That is first, that is principles of inheritance and variation. And third lesson, that is evolution. So first I will complete the first lesson, then sir will start second lesson, and then we will see the evolution. Fine. So today we are going to start genetics, that is principles of inheritance and variation. Very important lesson. This lesson is a bit lengthy. We are going to see number of things in this lesson. So without wasting time, let's start this lesson, that is principles of inheritance and variation. I have written here genetics, so it's same. Now chalo, let's see. So first we will see what is a genetics. Fine. So genetics, it is a branch of biology which deals with study of heredity and variation. What we study in this? So genetics is a branch of biology. It is a branch of biology which deals with study of heredity and variations. Fine. So it is a common branch again for botany as well as zoology, because principles of inheritance are applicable same for each and every living organisms, although there are some exceptions. So we will see those exceptions whenever we will come to that point. So genetics, it is a branch of biology which deals with study of heredity and variation. So first we will see what is a heredity. Fine. In today's class we are going to see number of terminologies which we are going to use regularly in this lesson. You might be knowing these terms because in your 10th standard you had this lesson, you learned this lesson, but that was very small part of this. So I hope you all know these terms, but still I'll explain all these terms again because frequently we are going to use those terminologies. Fine. So let's see first one, what is mean by heredity. Just try to understand this. In this lesson we are going to learn so many things, but we will write minimum things because theoretical part, it is not asked much. Theoretical questions will not be asked from this lesson. Means for MCQ also, for MCQ usually some numericals will come, some crosses will be asked. So wherever it is required, that time I will write down the notes on the board. Otherwise from my explanation you can write down notes if you want, but try to understand the concept properly. The major problem right now we are facing that in a recorded lecture I am not getting whether you are able to understand or not. So it's very important to understand each and every concept. So first listen properly, try to understand everything. Now we know that reproduction, it is the inherent capacity of each and every living cell. In 11th standard we have learned that Rudolf Virchow in his cell theory explained that omnicellular e cellular means all the time new cells arise from pre-existing cell. That time what happened? Newly formed offsprings, they receive characters from their parents, means whatever we have right now that we have got from our parents. So transmission of characters, transmission of features from parents to offsprings, from one generation to the next generation, that is known as heredity. Fine. Heredity means what? It is a transmission of characters, transmission of features, okay, from parents to offsprings, from first generation to the next generation, that is known as heredity. Now what is mean by variations? Yeah, we have received all the things from our parents, but are we exact copies of our parents? If you have some siblings, if you have brother or sisters, are you all look alike? No, it's not possible. Two individuals, they don't look alike. So variation means what? It is a degree of difference. Okay, always there are differences. Now obviously this is related to particular species. Fine. So variations, these are the degrees of differences among offsprings or among progenies, as well as progenies and parents. Okay, we don't look similar like our parents, okay, as well as among siblings, okay, we also have different characteristics, okay, morphological characteristics, behavioral characteristics, all. So these differences are called as variations. Fine. So genetics deals with what? Genetic deals with study of heredity, that is the transmission of characters from parents to offspring or from one generation to the next generation, whereas variation, it is a degree of differences among offsprings, okay, as well as offsprings and parents, okay, that is known as variation. Fine. So heredity, it is a transmission of characters from one to next generation, whereas variation, these are the differences. Fine. Now the term genetics, so we know that Gregor Mendel, he performed hybridization experiments and he postulated his theories. Okay, those theories we commonly call as Mendelism. We are going to study them in detail. Okay, but the term genetics was not coined by him. So the term genetics was coined by W. Bateson. Okay, term genetics was coined by W. Bateson. Okay, again you have to remember in this lesson, whichever scientist reference will come, that you have to remember, because MCQs come on this part. Fine. So term genetics was coined by W. Bateson. We'll see few more scientists along with their contribution, that is the father of genetics, father of modern genetics, and father of experimental genetics. So we all know that Gregor Johann Mendel, who performed hybridization experiments on pea plant, okay, and he gave theories or postulates of transmission or heredity. Fine. So Gregor Mendel, called as father of genetics. Fine. So father of genetics, Gregor Mendel, then next one, father of modern genetics, okay, so father of modern genetics, W. Bateson, father of modern genetics, father of modern genetics, W. Bateson, okay, whereas father of experimental genetics, okay, father of experimental genetics, okay, that is T. H. Morgan, okay, T. H. Morgan, okay, father of experimental genetics, okay. You might be knowing that T.H. Morgan worked with fruit flies, that is Drosophila melanogaster, and he gave concept of linkage, crossing over. So he is known as father of experimental genetics. Those things also we are going to learn, okay, in our later lectures. Fine. So father of genetics, Gregor Mendel, father of modern genetics, W. Batson, and father of experimental genetics, it is T.H. Morgan. Fine. So we have seen what is genetics, what is heredity, variation, and these three scientists. Next we will see there are some applied branches of genetics. Means what can we do in genetics? Accordingly, there are three branches of genetics, namely transmission genetics. First branch of genetics, it is known as transmission genetics. Second is known as molecular genetics. Okay, and third one is known as population genetics. Population genetics, based on application of genetics in the different sources or in different areas, this genetic could be classified in three branches. Okay, the first one, transmission genetics. In case of transmission genetics, what we do, we study the pattern of inheritance, we study the pattern of heredity from one generation to the next generation. So that is known as transmission genetics. Okay, molecular genetics means what? We study genetics at a molecular level. So there we study structure and function of genes, okay, or how the genes are transmitted to next tropic level or to the progenies. That is known as molecular genetics. And population genetics means what? When we use knowledge of genetics or knowledge of these genes for the population purpose, to understand or to know different types of genetic disorders, okay, how these disorders are caused, how to overcome or how to recover these things. There is a concept called as genetic counseling, okay. Fine, if a particular family has a history of a particular genetic disorders, and if the particular couple want to stop that specific trait for the next generation, then there are some genetic counselor who study history of that particular disorder. So when we apply the knowledge of genetics to solve the problem, okay, related to genes or related to genetics, that is known as population genetics. Fine. So three types of genetic based on its application. We'll write down this because this part is not mentioned in NCERT. Fine. So transmission genetics means what? It is a study of transmission of character. Okay. So in this we study transmission of genes. Okay, from one generation to the next generation, from generation to generation. Okay, from generation to generation. In molecular genetics, we study gene at molecular level. Okay, study of genes. Study of genes at molecular level. Study of genes at molecular level. And population genetics means we study or we apply the knowledge of genetics for application of Mendel's laws or the other principle of genetics to population studies. Application of Mendel's laws or other principles of genetics, other principles of genetics to population studies, to population study, okay, or to study the population. Fine. So these are three branches of genetics. Okay, rarely question will come on this, but when we will study the pedigree analysis, at that time reference of population genetics will come. That time you should know what is mean by population genetics, fine? So these are three types of genetics, fine? Now after this we will study some important concepts, fine, or some important terminologies which are going to use in this lesson. From that few you might be knowing, but again it will be a revision. So important terms, and then we will move toward Mendelism, fine. Important terms, okay, some important terms we will see. Okay, fine. The first term that we will see, that is a trait. Okay, first term, trait. Okay, now what is a trait? Trait, it is any character which is genetically controlled. We say that Mendel selected 7 pairs of contrasting characters or 7 pairs of contrasting traits. So what is this trait? Trait, it is a genetically expressed or genetically regulated any character that is known as trait. So trait, it is genetically determined character. Trait, genetically determined character. Fine. That is known as trait. The next term, which is factors. Okay, factor. Trait, it is a genetically determined character. Now let's see what is mean by factor. Now factor means what? Factor, it is a unit of heredity. We know that Mendel, when he crossed different contrasting varieties of a feet, that time he said that something is responsible for transmission of this feature character from parents to offspring. At that time he was not knowing the concept of gene. So he called those factors or those things which are responsible or the units of heredity, for them he called as factors. So according to Mendel, Mendel first time used the word factor for units of heredity. So units of heredity or the information or those things which are transferred from parents to offspring. Okay, so that is known as factors. Soon factors term was replaced by, replaced into gene by Johansson, fine. So factors, pair of heredity, okay, or pair of inheritance, okay. The term factor was first time used by Mendel, okay, used by, sorry, not pair, unit of heredity, used by Mendel, fine, and factors were called as genes by Johansson, called as genes by Johansson. Okay, so Johansson gave the term gene to the Mendelian factors, fine, in 1909. So factors, now whenever we will see the Mendelian process or Mendelian postulate, that time we are going to use this term factors. So according to Mendel, these factors are nothing but the genes, fine, because that time gene concept was not available. So gene word given by Johnson in 1909, fine. Let's see the next concept, allele. Next concept, allele. Now what is the allele? You might have used this term before also. So allele is what? Allele, it is an alternative form of a gene, fine. Allele is alternative form of a gene located at a same position, located at a same position, or now this same position is also known as loci. Okay, singularly it is known as locus, at same position on homologous chromosomes. On homologous chromosome. Fine, huh? Now just try to understand this. What is mean by allele? As we know that in case of diploid organism, each gene it is represented twice. Or there is a chromosome pair. If we take examples of human being, we have 46 chromosomes, means we have 23 pairs of chromosomes. So in a pair, suppose this is the condition in a diploid organism. Fine. There are two chromosomes in a pair. Now, the gene, when it has alternative form, for example, Mendel selected one trait, that is the height of plant. Okay. So, he found that some plants were tall, some plants were dwarf. Means, if we consider the height, there are two conditions, either tall or dwarf. So these two are the alternative forms. So plant could be either tall or it could be dwarf. There could not be intermediate stage. Fine. So alternative form. Okay. So a diploid organism could receive allele or both the alleles which are same, or they could be dissimilar. Fine. Accordingly, we can call them as homozygous, heterozygous. Those terms also we will see now. So allele means what? These are the alternative forms of a gene. Yes, as there is a homologous pairing, as there are two chromosomes in a pair, homologous chromosome, a gene could have both the dominant gene, or there could be both the dominant allele, or one dominant, one recessive allele, or both the recessive allele. Okay? Very simple example, if I take height, when we consider height, height, it is a trait, any particular character. Plants could either receive allele for tallness or they could receive allele for dwarfness. Fine. Suppose for tallness we use, or for the height tallness we use the letter T. So suppose on one chromosome there is a capital T, another chromosome also there is a capital T. Another condition we can see, where one chromosome capital T, another chromosome of homologous pair may have small t. Or third condition we can see, where both the chromosome would receive small t. Fine, huh? Now what is mean by this locus? As you know that every gene, it is located at a specific position on a chromosome. Yes, we can map this gene. That concept, it is known as gene mapping. Fine. We can locate each and every gene on a chromosome. Fine. So these genes are located at a specific position. Okay. Position, it is same on homologous chromosome. Fine. Means the gene for height of plant. Sorry. The gene for height of plant, whether for tallness or for dwarfness, they are located at the same locus. Fine. So it is a position or location where particular allele is located. So that position of an allele or gene, it is known as, yes, locus. So singularly it is known as locus, many are loci. So if you see a condition, suppose I'll give this A, B and C. Fine. So in case of A, this is a homologous pair. Okay. So this is a homologous pair. Homologous pair. Fine. On that, the gene or the genes for height, say for tallness. As you know that tallness, it is a dominant character over dwarfness. So Mendel used some letters for that. So he used capital T for tallness and small t for dwarfness. Fine. So if the two have similar type of allele. Fine. So here you can see alternative forms are same. Fine. Here on one chromosome there is a dominant allele. On another chromosome there is a recessive allele. Fine. Here both they have recessive type of allele. So these are the two alternative forms. So gamete will receive only one chromosome at the time of reproduction. Fine. We know that during reproduction, number of chromosomes reduce. Ploidy level, it is reduced. Yes, haploid gametes are produced. So they receive the single copy of gene. So obviously, at the time of fertilization, ploidy level, it is restored. So we know that half genes, half chromosomes we receive from mother, half chromosomes we receive from father. Fine, too? Because egg and sperm, they contain only single set of chromosome. Means out of this pair, out of this homologous pair, egg or sperm receives only one chromosome. Fine, too? So this ploidy level, it is restored at the time of fertilization. So we receive 50% chromosomes from mother and 50% chromosomes from father. Fine, but still there is a variation. Why? Because of meiosis. At the time of meiosis, recombination of genes takes place. So that adds new genes. Okay, so that is known as allele. So allele, it is an alternative form of gene located on at the same locus on homologous chromosome. Fine, okay? So that is known as allele. Okay? Now the next term. Homozygous, heterozygous. So I will explain here only from these diagrams you will understand. Homozygous and heterozygous. Homozygous and heterozygous. Fine. We know that homo meaning similar and zygous obviously it is for zygote. Fine. So homozygous means what? Homozygous term we use for individual. Fine. But before that we will see what is mean by homozygote. Yes. Homozygote means what? A zygote which is formed by fusion of two gametes. Fine. By fusion of egg and sperm, where they carry similar type of allele. For example, if you see here, suppose this is the chromosome from male parent, fine. So here the sperm will receive only capital T. So if such sperm get fertilized with the egg cell, where egg cell also receive the capital T allele. So such a zygote where the chromosome or homologous pair or both the alleles, they are dominant, okay, or recessive but are of same type. That is known as homozygous. It could be homozygous dominant or it could be homozygous recessive. What I said, similar type of allele. Okay, it doesn't mean that every time it should be dominant or it should be recessive. It could be dominant also, it could be recessive also. Accordingly, we call it as a homozygous dominant or homozygous recessive. But in homozygous condition, homologous chromosome or gene has both the similar type of alleles, either dominant or recessive. Fine. So that zygote, it is known as homozygote, whereas individual is known as homozygous. So when we say homozygous dominant, means that individual has both the dominant alleles for particular trait. Fine. When we say homozygous recessive, that time we mean that the individual has both the recessive allele for particular trait. Students, this lesson is going to run for 1 month. Number of things we are going to see. Numerical, later we are going to study at higher level. Okay, so for that, these things, these terminology should be clear. Okay, so whenever we will do practice or problem, that time, then time should not come. That again, you have to revise your notes and you have to see what is the meaning of this stuff. So as soon as I say homologous or as soon as I say homozygous dominant, immediately it should click in your mind. Homozygous dominant means the individual is dominant or it is homozygous for both the dominant allele. When I say homozygous recessive means individual, it is recessive or it has both the recessive allele. That is known as homozygous. So when individual has both similar alleles, that is known as homozygous. It could be homozygous dominant or homozygous recessive. Now what is mean by heterozygous? Heterozygous meaning different. This condition where individual has one dominant allele and one recessive allele or two dissimilar alleles, that individual is known as heterozygous. And a zygote which is formed, obviously it is known as heterozygote. Fine. So homozygous in heterozygous. Fine. So homozygous means having similar allele. It could be either homozygous dominant or recessive. Heterozygotes, okay, here they have this similar allele, that is one dominant and one recessive. Obviously, dominant character expresses So heterozygous will show dominant character. Fine. Then next concept we will see. Homologous heterozygous over. We will see now hemizygous. Okay. What is mean by hemizygous? Next terminology. Hemizygous. Yes, hemizygous. Fine. Now just now we learned that each gene has two alleles, but there are some genes which have only one allele, okay, or only one there is no contrasting character for such genes. So that individual or that type of chromosome, it is known as hemizygous chromosome. The example of hemizygous genes or hemizygous chromosome, fine. Y chromosome in male, fine. The example or the male individuals are hemizygous for X-linked characters, fine. In upcoming classes, we are going to study X-linked inheritance or the Mendelian inheritance. X-linked inheritance means what? There are some genes which are located specially on X chromosome, and they are responsible for number of characters, or some features they are regulated by genes located on X chromosome, fine. In case of males, we know that X chromosome, it is much larger in size. It is a metacentric chromosome, okay? Whereas Y chromosome, it is shorter. It is telocentric. Now here, we know that in case of homologous chromosome, genes are located at the same locus. What about this? The genes which are located on the upper arm of chromosome, X chromosome, there is no homologous chromosome or the alternative form of Y chromosome. Fine. So here, the genes which are located on X chromosome on male, these are known as hemizygous, because they don't have alternative form. They don't have alternative form of this. So they are called as hemizygous. So whenever gene has only one allele, such genes are known as hemizygous genes. Okay, or the individual is known as hemizygous. Fine. So homozygous over, heterozygous over, hemizygous over. Fine. I hope there is no problem. Hemizygous you have to remember, because special type of numericals or MCQs will be there, in that they mention in hemizygous individual. This is the condition. So that time you should recall what is mean by hemizygous. So hemizygous means there is no alternative form. Individual has only one gene or allele. So that has to be expressed in the particular individual. Fine. So that is known as hemizygous. Okay. The next terminology. Phenotypes and genotypes. Phenotype and genotype. Okay. Next two terms, phenotypes and genotypes. So phenotypes means what? Phenotypes, that is a physical character, morphological character of a particular organism or trait. And the genes which are responsible for that, that is known as genotype. So genotype, that is the genetic constitution, genetic makeup of an organism for a particular trait, that is known as genotype. So when we write capital T, small t, so the genes which are responsible for that, that is known as genotype. Okay? Whereas physical expression or the morphological expression by those genes, that is known as phenotype. Height of plant, tallness, dwarfness, that is known as phenotype. Axial flower, okay, apical flower, violet fruits, okay, violet flowers, white flower, green pod, yellow pod, all these are the features, these are the morphological characters, expressions of gene. Fine. So expression of gene, morphological or the physical character, that is known as phenotype. Genotype, it is a genetic makeup, genetic constitution, that is known as genotype. Fine. Phenotype and genotype. Then hybrid vigor or heterosis. This you might have learned in the strategies lesson. Hybrid vigor. Or heterosis. hybrid vigor or heterosis means what? Whenever hybrid organism, okay, it is superior than parent. So whenever hybrid individual or whenever progeny receives, can say, more features or good characteristics, or it is superior than parents, that is known as hybrid vigor or heterosis. Fine. So when progeny or hybrid, it has some superior genes, superior characters than parents, then that is known as hybrid vigor or heterosis. Fine. The next one, inbreeding depression. This also you have learned. Inbreeding depression. Okay. So inbreeding depression means what? As you know that self-pollinated plants, in case of self-pollinated plant, if we continue it for several generation, one time will come that these plants will not respond to it. Okay, huh? That is known as inbreeding depression. Okay, huh? Progeny will not produce, viable seeds will not produce, that is known as inbreeding depression. Fine. Huh? So these are some terms, huh? And few more. Sorry, because there are so many terms, I am just trying to list out maximum. Next one, monohybrid, cross as well as ratio, dihybrid, trihybrid, monohybrid, dihybrid, cross or ratio. Monohybrid cross or ratio, dihybrid cross or ratio, trihybrid cross or ratio. Fine. Now monohybrid means what? Whenever a cross or hybridization is performed between a parents considering one pair of contrasting characters. Fine. Try to understand what is mean by monohybrid cross. It is a cross or hybridization which is performed by considering only one pair of contrasting character or one trait at a time. For example, when Mendel crossed tall plants with dwarf plants, okay, he considered only one character, that is height of plant at a time. Such crosses are known as monohybrid cross. Fine. Huh? So in monohybrid cross, we use only one gene, okay, only one pair or only one trait. So that is known as monohybrid. Tall, dwarf, that is for height, flower, color, purple, violet. So at a time he considered only one pair of contrasting character, one factor or one feature, that is known as monohybrid cross. So cross which is performed in parents considering only one feature at a time, that is known as monohybrid cross. Okay. When we perform the cross, we get progeny in a specific ratio. Okay. So the ratio which we get after monohybrid cross, ratio of progeny, okay, that is known as monohybrid ratio. Okay. We are going to see later on what are the different ratios Mendel obtained from its crosses. So that ratio, it is known as monohybrid ratio. Fine. Second one, dihybrid. Obviously, dihybrid, when we consider two features, for example, height of a plant along with pod color. So at a time when we consider two features, two pairs of contrasting characters, if you can remember, just remember from your 10th standard, you had one crossover round and wrinkled seeds. Okay, huh? So round, wrinkled, and your green, yellow. So whenever we consider two pairs of contrasting characters or two features, such cross is known as dihybrid cross. Okay, and the ratio of progeny which we obtained from that cross, that is known as dihybrid ratio. Obviously, monohybrid and dihybrid ratios would differ. Fine. When we consider three pairs, for example, height of plant along with that position of flower along with that pod color, fine. So when we consider three pairs of characters, that is known as trihybrid cross, and the ratio which we get, that is known as trihybrid ratio. Mendel performed all these three types of crosses. He performed monohybrid crosses also, dihybrid cross also, as well as trihybrid cross. Fine. So these are some terminologies, fine, which we are going to use normally I hope this much information it is enough. So wherever while teaching, if I feel that you are not aware of these things, that time again I'll explain that. Fine. So these are the basic things. Now let's start with Mendelism. Okay, we'll have a bit history of Mendelism, because sometimes questions can be framed on that part, more specifically birth year, experimental year of Mendel, birthplace and everything. So little bit we'll mention that part, and then we will move toward his postulates. Fine. So first we'll mention these things. So let's start Mendelism. Mendelism means what? Mendelism, it is a name given to the principles which Mendel postulated. So study of those principles, those theories which were put forth by Mendel when he performed, or when he performed several experiments on sweet pea, when he performed experiment on the garden pea, that is your Pisum sativum. Fine. So those postulates are known as Mendelism. So first we will have little bit information about Mendel. So Gregor Johann Mendel, born on Gregor Johann Mendel, born on July 22nd, born on July 22nd, 1822. His lifespan 1822 to 1884. Okay. Place at Hessendorf. These names are so difficult. Hessendorf in Austria. In Austria, the name of village is Silesia. At Silesia village, Okay, now his experimental period, 1856. Experimental years, this could be also asked, 1856 to 1863. So he worked for 7 years. 7 years he worked on garden pea, that is our normal gibble pea, Pisum sativum. Fine. He was working in an Augustinian monastery as a monk in Austria itself. Actually, his farmer, his father, he was a farmer, and when he was continuously working in his farm, that time Mendel thought that how these progenies they are receiving spurs, or how they look alike, or the basic question which was came in his mind, that how from pea plants only pea could produce. Okay, so then he thought, thinking behind that, and then he worked with this plant. Okay, he worked for these 7 years. But the major bad luck of Mendel is that he died in 1822. Till that time, no one was ready to accept his work. No one appreciated him. His work was not recognized. There are so many reasons behind this. Those reasons also we will discuss. But no one was ready to accept his work, or whatever information he brought from his experiments. Okay. So contribution, no one gave him any credit for his work. So when Mendel died in 1884, 16 years after that, in 1900, okay, three scientists independently rediscovered his work. Okay, huh? Three scientists belonging to three different countries. Okay, they worked with different plants, and they found the similar types of results which Mendel observed. Okay, so that time Mendel works rediscovered and credit was given to Mendel. What a bad luck. Okay, huh? When he was living that time, he published his work in the journal. He published his paper, that is hybridization and pea plant. But no one was ready to accept the concept which he brought ahead. So for that, or after his death, after 16 years after his death, okay, the credit again it came to Mendel. So that point also we will mention. So he published his results. In a science journal, Nature for Schendelgeren, in 1865, right? He published one paper also. In that he gave all the details, okay, or all the mathematical details, okay, mathematical results which he obtained from his cross in one paper, experiment in plant hybridization. He published his results, in a paper named Experiments in Plant Hybridization. After his death, okay, in 1900, Mendel's work rediscovered, okay? After 16 years, by his death, Mendel's postulates were rediscovered. Mendel's postulates were rediscovered by three scientists independently. We'll mention their names also because questions can come on this. Karl Korenz from Germany. Second one, Hugo de Vries from Holland. And Schermak from Austria. From this, Karl Koren, he performed experiments on maize plant. So he worked on maize plant, okay? Whereas Hugo de Vries, he worked on evening primrose. Okay? Whereas Schermak, he worked with different flowering plants. Fine. So this is some general information. Questions can come on Mendel birth date, means date of birth, year. So this you have to remember. Experimental year 1856 to 1863, 7 years. Name of journal, name of his paper, research paper that he published, and who rediscovered Mendel works. Okay, so those three scientists. They independently or they worked on different parts and found the similar types of results, okay, like mental. Fine. So these are some things. Now we will start with experiment of Mendel. What Mendel exactly did. So first, that is selection of plant. Which plant he selected and why is he selected that plant. So now let's see the experiment which was performed by Mendel. So first point, that is selection of plant or experimental material. So which experimental material he used? So first, experimental material. Fine. Mendel for his experiment selected garden pea. Okay. So that was the edible pea. He selected garden pea because of some reasons. Those reasons we will discuss. Garden pea, our regular edible pea. Fine. Biological name, Picum sativum. Picum sativum. Immediately recall its family also, structure or the characteristic of the family also, because 1 year question had come like this. What was the floral formula of the flower which Mendel used? Fine. Or what was the estivation? So that point immediately recall along with this. So Picum sativum belonging to family Leguminosae, Fabaceae. So there is a special type of estivation. Yes, there is a axillary estivation. Then your arrangement of petal questions had come on this part. Fine. So Picum sativum, chromosome number 2N is equal to 14. So diploid number, chromosomes 2N equal to 14. There were 7 pairs of chromosomes. Fine. Now, why he selected pea plant? Again, very important. Why he selected? So what were the advantages in the selection of pea plant? Advantages of pea plant. Number of advantages are there. Advantages of pea plant. Fine. We will discuss one by one. First one, easily available. This plant is easily available. Easily available. Okay. Sweet pea, your garden pea, edible pea, we are regularly using as a food material. It is available everywhere. Fine. So it was easily available. Second, with short lifespan. Okay. That plant had short lifespan of 2 to 3 weeks. See here. Short lifespan of 2 to 3 weeks means within 2 to 3 weeks that plant complete the life cycle and we get the result. Because in this, what Mendel wanted to see, Mendel wanted to see the transmission of characters from one generation to the next generation. So obviously he could get the result within a short duration so that he can study the particular trait for number of generations. Okay. So this plant has a shorter lifespan, about 2 to 3 weeks. Within 2 to 3 weeks, this plant complete the life cycle, the fruit and they form their seeds. Fine. The next character. This plant is easy to grow with minimum expenditure. Okay, huh? As well as minimum aftercare. Plant is easy to grow. Plant is easy to grow with minimum aftercare. Means more attention it is not required once we plant or once we sow the seeds or once we plant this, it grows. Okay? So with minimum aftercare, that much attention it is not required. Aftercare it is not required. Fine. The next one, that is availability of pure varieties. Next advantage, availability of pure varieties. Fine. Just add this one term in your list. Varieties, pure line. What do you mean by pure line? Yes, because Mendel used pure lines for his experiments. So pure lines means what? Hmm? Whenever characters or traits are transferred from one generation to the next generation as it is. Hmm? So, whenever homozygous condition, it is maintained. Whenever in a cross, we get the similar type of parent. For example, when we cross tall parents among themselves, we get the tall plant. So, for every generation in a homozygous cross, so for pure line, self-pollination is required. Okay, so self-pollination results in maintenance of characters or transmission of characters, means we get the similar type of offsprings like parent. So such parents are known as pure lines, means there is no recombination or there is no hybrid characters come. So these are the pure genes. Yes, huh? So only if we go on continuing self-pollination for so many generations, one day will come that that individual is lost the vigor, fertile offsprings will not reproduce. That is known as inbreeding differentiation. But if for so many generations, if we go for the self-pollination, we get the pure line. So for pure line, every time we have to observe that offspring, it is receiving similar type of character from parent or not. So such known as pure variety. So as this plant, it is self-pollinated, this is also one advantage. Plant is self-pollinated so that we can get the pure lines, as well as this plant also offer controlled hybridization. It means we can perform hybridization experiments also, and the progenies which are produced from them, these are fertile progeny. So F1 progeny or hybrids are fertile. This is also advantage. Hybrids are fertile. Otherwise, Mendel would not be able to use the seeds for next generation. Fine. So these are some reasons. Okay. So for that sake, he selected the pea plant. One more advantage is that easily detectable contrasting characters. Easily observable contrasting characters. Okay. Easily detectable contrasting characters means whichever characters he selected, those could be external. We can easily find height of plant, twig, shape of a pod, size of pod, color of pod. Okay. So all these things could be easily recognizable. Okay. Those things were easily observable. So this is also one of the benefit behind selection of pea plant. So these are the reason why Mendel selected pea plants for his experiment. Fine. Now, next we will see selection of traits. Which traits or which characters he selected? We all know that Mendel selected 7 pairs of contrasting characters, but he started with 34 varieties. Yes, huh? He selected 34 varieties, pure line varieties. Okay, variety, I am saying same variety having a contrasting character means what? When we say tall and dwarf, they belong to same variety. But as tallness and dwarfness, these two are contrasting characters. So he selected tallness or one tall plant, one dwarf plant. So such 7 contrasting characters or 7 varieties he used for his final experiment. But he started with 34 different varieties or 34 pure lines. From that he started his experiment. After his first set of experiments, he eliminated some characters and then he came to 22 varieties. From that 22 varieties, finally he selected 7 varieties for his experiment, and he used only one pair of contrasting characters at a time to perform his experiments. So initially he used 34 selection of traits. Selection of trait. Initially, he selected 34 varieties. Pure line varieties. then selected 22 from that, and finally he worked with 7 varieties. Finally he worked on 7 pure line varieties. Okay, we'll make a tabular form to know which are these 7 varieties. Huh? So he selected 7 varieties, and for his initial experiments, he selected only 1 pair of contrasting character. Okay, for that cross. Fine. So finally, so a question will come. So at the beginning, he started with 34 varieties. From that, he selected 22, and finally, he used only 7 varieties for his work. Now let's see which are those 7 pairs of contrasting characters. So just make one table for that. Okay, and in that table, we'll mention those 7 pairs of contrasting characters. Okay. So, serial number, character, from that which one is dominant, recessive, and chromosome number, on which particular gene is located. Fine. Chromosome number on which particular gene is located. Okay. If you can able to recall, just recall from your 10th standard. Because you had all these things. First one. First category. With respect to plant height. Okay. Plant height. Yes, Now Mendel used particular letters for these dominant and recessive character. We have learned that every gene has 2 alternative form. Fine, So he used particular letters to denote that type of character. He used capital letter for dominant character and small letter for recessive characters. So these letters or symbols also we are going to write. So for plant height, tallness is a dominant character, okay, over dwarfness. So dwarfness, it is a recessive character, it is denoted by letter T. So the capital T, it is for dominant character, small t, it is for recessive character. It is located on chromosome number 4. Yes, now we are the information about which gene is located on which chromosome, that was not explained by Mendel. I told you that time concept of gene was not there, concept of chromosome was not there. Afterward, Blix, he gave, or when he worked, he performed experiments again. That time he found that these Mendelian characters or traits, they were located on this specific chromosome. So now this table, obviously it is a modified. This dominant, recessive, now we know that dominant it is or recessive, tallness is dominant, shortness is dominant. But when Mendel performed the experiment, from that he got these results. Okay, so as per his observations, then he thought that tallness it is a dominant character and dwarfness it is a recessive character. So whatever we are writing in this table or whatever we use this information, these are the outcomes of Mendel result. Right? So the gene for height of plant, either on tallness or dwarfness, is located on chromosome number 4. The next character related to flower. For flower, there are 2 characters. Flower color and flower position. Okay, flower color and flower position. In flower color, violet color is dominant over white color. Okay, so violet, capital V, and white, small V. Genes are located on chromosome number 1. Fine. For flower position, axial axial position, okay, of flower, it is dominant over terminal position. So axial flower, denoted as capital A, is dominant over terminal flower, small a. Genes are located again on chromosome number 4. Fine, huh? Genes are located on chromosome number 4. Next one, flower over. Now pod. Again in pod, pod shape and pod color. Pod shape and pod color. Okay. In case of pod shape, inflated, that is smooth one, was dominant over constricted. So inflated by capital I and constricted, okay, that is small I. So inflated means smooth one, so smooth pod is dominant over constricted one. Genes are located again on chromosome number 4. Fine. Pod color, in case of pod color, green color is dominant over yellow color. Fine. So green pods are dominant over yellow. Okay. So green, capital G, yellow, small g. Genes are located on chromosome number 5. Fine. So two more characters related with the pod, that is pod shape and pod color. And remaining two are related with seed. Seed shape and seed color. Seed shape and seed color. In case of seed shape, smooth seeds, they were dominant over wrinkled. So smooth seeds, capital S, or round also. In your textbook, round is given. So round, capital R, okay, and wrinkled, small r. Fine. Round seeds and wrinkled seed located on chromosome number 7. So genes were located on chromosome number 7. And for seed color, yellow is dominant over green. Students get confused in the pod color and seed color. In case of pod color, green color is dominant whereas yellow is recessive. In case of seed color, yellow is dominant, which is denoted as capital Y, whereas green is recessive, small y. Fine, huh? This remember whenever you will solve problem, that time just see whether it is asked for the pod color or whether it is for seed color. For pod color, green is dominant, yellow is recessive. For seed color, yellow is dominant and green is recessive. Fine. Genes are located on chromosome number 1. This chromosome number you have to remember. Questions can come that out of 7 pairs of traits, which characters are located on first chromosomes, which characters are, or which genes are located on 7, on 4th or 5th, or how many features, how many genes were located on first chromosome. So either with respect to number, or they can ask you the specific character also. So this table you have to remember, because all the crosses which we are going to learn after this, these crosses are based on these symbols. So these symbols also you have to by heart, to practice by writing one or two times. Fine, huh? We are not going to write this character. So whenever we write the capital A, it means axial flower. Whenever we write the small g, that is for pod color, that is for the yellow pod. So all the symbols also you have to keep in mind. Fine. So this table, just do practice, revise this table properly, okay? So these are the 7 pairs of contrasting characters. As I told you, number of chromosomes or on which chromosome particular gene is located, that given by Blix. So again I am writing here, this chromosome number was given by Blix. Okay, he gave the position of this chromosome or on which number of chromosome Mendelian trait was present. So that was given by Blext. Okay, but now you have to remember all these things. Fine. So this is about the 7 pairs of contrasting characters. Fine. Now, after this, we will see what exactly Mendel performed and what types of results he found. Okay, today we will not start directly for the crosses because first you have to revise this class or revise these things. In the next class we'll start actually with these experiments, but before that we will see what methodology he used for his experiment. So steps in hybridization, obviously we know that Mendel performed different hybridization experiment. Although pea plant naturally it is a self-pollinating, but we know that if there is a self-pollination, then parents receive similar type of characteristic, there is very less scope for variation. And Mendel wanted to study in what way this variation comes in the progeny. See, Mendel performed, that was in the 19th century. But if we go back, much back before Christ period, that time also these things were happening. Agriculturists were doing these things. See, whenever we cross two plant or whenever we select a particular variety, agriculture, it is our part in the since ancient time. Agriculture, it is present, we are doing the agriculture, the span of before Christ also. So what agriculturists were doing, every year they sow seeds, every year they hybridize, or they, you can say, they grab different types of varieties, hybridization is performed. From that they get the superior varieties, and these superior varieties, this seed they sow for the, or they keep for the next years. Fine. So obviously what happened, people were doing these things, but they were not knowing why these offsprings, they are receiving the superior characters from their parents, or in what way they are receiving this information from their parents. So no one thought, okay, about that. But hybridization was there before Mendel also. Mendel used technique of hybridization for his experiments, okay? And from that he got lot of mathematical data. Yes, sir. One of the reason of Mendelian success is that use of mathematics. Okay, he used lot of mathematics. He used biostat for that. So he recorded all his data. Fine. So he performed hybridization experiment. Pea plant offer hybridization also, cross pollination also, and the progeny which is produced from that hybridization, it is again fertile. Means we can use those seeds, and plants can be raised, as well as those plants can flower and they can also fruit. So let's see what are the steps in fertilization or steps in hybridization. Steps in hybridization, or which steps he performed in hybridization. In previous lesson in strategies, in plant breeding, you have learned this. So now you know what are the steps in hybridization. So quickly we will review those steps. In this, what we do? In reproduction, reproduction angiosperm, we have seen how hybrid plants are raised. So in that, what we do? First we remove the anther or the male reproductive structure. So that is known as emasculation. Fine. Now, as you know that pea flowers, these are bisexual. There is a androecium or stamens also, as well as there is a pistil also, because that is a naturally self-pollinated plant. So for experiment, why Mendel did? He selected 50% of flowers as a male flowers and 50% flowers as a female flowers. Means what? From 50% flowers, he removed stamen, and from 50% parents, he removed carpel. Fine. So emasculation, it is a step when we remove the stamen, because we wanted to hybridize that plant, okay, with the different type of pollen grains. So to avoid the self-fertilization, we remove the anthers whenever flower is in a bud condition. So for that, he performed the first step is emasculation, that is removal of anther from flower in a bud condition to prevent the self-pollination. Fine. After emasculation, what we do? We do the bagging. Why? Because now we have removed the stamen from that flower. But there are some pollen grains which might be traversed for wind current and they may get deposited on the stigma and could offer the self-pollination or could offer the unwanted pollination. Yes, so bagging it is done to prevent the unwanted pollination. We want to dust a specific type of pollen grains. Fine. So to prevent the unwanted pollination, bagging it is done. After bagging, what we do? We dust the pollen grains of our variety. Okay, so dusting of pollen, we do the hybridization dusting of pollens of desired variety. Okay, so we dust the pollen grains of the desired variety. Now once we dust it, after that what we do? We do the tagging. Okay, we put a tag on that and we mention the information that on which day experiment has done or hybridization has done, which character it is considered in that, when to open or when flowers or fruits will form. Fine. So a tag it is then. Once tag it is then, crossing will occur and then that is the collection of seed. Now once tag, then crossing will take place. Okay. And then collection of seeds. Collection of seeds. So hybridization will take place. Fruits will form. Now we have collect the seeds from pods or from the fruits. We have to sow those seeds. Once we sow those seeds, we get the plants and in that we observe our results. Fine. So these are the steps which are performed, or these steps which are performed by Mendel in his hybridization experiment. Fine. So in today's lecture we have seen different things related to Mendel's experiment. Okay. In next class, we will start actually with his experiment and his theories or principles. This law of dominance, law of segregation, law of independent assortment. Okay. And different types of crosses which he performed. That is monohybrid crosses, dihybrid crosses, trihybrid crosses. Fine. So this is for the day. You have to revise this part properly. In NCERT, not much details are given, but still you read the NCERT. Fine. Just try to see what part it is given in this. So in next lecture, fine, we will start with the experiments which were performed by Mendel. In that we will see monohybrid, dihybrid, trihybrid crosses, ratios and some numericals based on that. Fine. So this is for the day. Now we will meet in tomorrow's class. Okay. Fine.